What big cat version of macOS 10 is the best? Well, today we're gonna pit them against each other and see what is the true S tier. And to make things more fun, I asked the audience to vote and rank all of their own operating systems on their own tier list. I sealed away my own tier list back in October, and we're gonna see how close it is to the audience results. So if you're ready, let's go. Sponsored by Linode. Hey guys, how are you all doing? If you're new here, welcome. My name is Krazy Ken, and you're probably wondering what's up with the jacket. Well, it's actually a macOS 10 jacket from Apple's Worldwide Developers Conference. I just thought it would be fitting today, you know, given the theme that we're talking about. Okay, maybe not literally fitting, it's the only one I could find, but you know what I mean. So here's how I'll do things. I will rank every big cat version of macOS 10 based on features, stability, public reception, and to throw in some extra subjectivity, my personal experience. And I don't want to give out participation trophies. If two systems were really good, but one is slightly less good than the other, that one is going to get bumped down a rank. I'm going to be a little aggressive with my judging. And truly, I only want to give one system the true honor of S tier. So let's start with macOS 10.0. Cheetah. In the mid-90s, Apple's current macOS was in dire need of a significant technical overhaul in order to keep it competitive in the market. So in 1997, Apple finalized the deal to acquire Steve Jobs' company, Next, and the powerful technologies inside the Unix-based NextStep/OpenStep operating system. This gave birth to a rewritten macOS named macOS 10, with new technical features such as preemptive multitasking, protected memory, and killer graphics capabilities with the Quartz imaging model. On top of that, macOS 10 ushered forth a new user interface to replace macOS 9's Platinum, named Aqua. Bottom line, macOS 10 was gearing up to be a stable, powerful, and user-friendly OS, with the goal of marrying the power of Unix with the simplicity of Macintosh. But it came at a price. Classic macOS apps that ran on version 9 and earlier would not inherit the new features, the new interface, or the new technical benefits. None of that would work. However, macOS 10 could still run those apps in the classic environment as is. The good news is Apple introduced Carbon API so developers could tune their applications to inherit the new macOS 10 benefits without requiring the developer to rewrite the whole application. But if a developer did want to write an all-new application for macOS 10, they could use the brand new Cocoa APIs. So technical stuff aside, the most exciting part about macOS 10 was its new design and the Aqua user interface. macOS 10's interface looked and felt like water. Steve Jobs said one of the design goals was when you see it, you want to lick it. Semi-transparent menus and title bars were present throughout the system. This was something no other consumer OS offered on the market. We take drop shadows and translucent graphics for granted today, but in 2001, this was practically unheard of. Some of my favorite Aqua touches are how the default button in a dialog box just pulsates subtly. And I also like how these boxes attach to windows via sheets, and they intelligently rearrange the window to make space to display everything you need to see, and when the sheet closes, the window moves back. And of course, the dock. macOS 10.0 introduced the dock to the Mac environment for the first time ever, and this is a feature still present today, 21 years later. But macOS 10 wasn't all perfect. There were some performance slump issues, especially with application launch times, and some handy features from macOS 9 were just gone, like file burning to CDs via the Finder. That was gone. So was DVD playback. But it was a rewrite! Despite it being version 10.0, when you rewrite a program, especially an operating system, you have to treat it like a 1.0 for a while. And on top of the technical issues, there were businesses that didn't want to upgrade so quickly because there were some compatibility concerns, which, again, happens with a rewrite. That's just natural. It's okay to wait for a little bit. In the end, I consider Cheetah an early adopter release. It's not going to be for everyone. But it did go on sale on March 24th, 2001 for $129. But because it's not fully baked yet, I'm going to give Cheetah an E today.
Fully baked.
But Apple is just getting started. Let's move on to macOS 10.1, Puma. Puma was more of a glorified dot update for Cheetah, but it was much needed. Performance was improved in the system, and Finder CD burning and DVD playback were reintroduced. Also, menu bar extras were introduced with this release, something we still use today in macOS 12 Monterey. System preferences was also redesigned with a more logical arrangement of icons. And Puma was a free upgrade to Cheetah users, which sounds fair. It seems like it's getting macOS 10 back on track, and because of that, I'm gonna give it a C. But now, it's time for the next big cat, and I'm talking about Jaguar. Apple really pushed the cat analogies with Jaguar, They even used Pixar technology to render the fur for the logo. Jaguar introduced Quartz Extreme, which treated window elements as textures so they could be rendered by the graphics processor, freeing up those tasks from the CPU. And Quartz Extreme will be very useful for an upcoming feature in the next system. Hint, hint. Jaguar also introduced the first version of iChat and Rendezvous for zero configuration networking, which was useful for file sharing and setting up printers. And Jaguar also introduced Universal Access for the first time, which gives users accessibility features to make it easier to interact with the OS. So macOS 10 just seems to keep getting better and better. That's great, but because of the cat puns in the marketing, I'm afraid I'm gonna have to give Jaguar an F. Okay, I'll give it a B. I was just kidding. Kidding. I meant to say kidding. Okay, we need to move on to Panther before I make another catastrophic pun. Catastrophic. Panther introduced a redesigned Finder with a sidebar and action menu. Plus, it introduced fast user switching with that sexy cube animation. Funny enough, Steve Jobs actually publicly admitted that this was a good feature that Windows did first.
This is one feature, I gotta be honest, Windows beat us to this.
iChat now had video support, and file vault encryption was also introduced, and is still in macOS today. And you know what else is in macOS today? Safari! Panther was the first major release of macOS 10 to come bundled with Apple's new web browser. But arguably, the best feature in Panther was Exposé, a visually attractive way to spread out all your open windows and multitask with ease. You could also shove them aside to get easy access to your desktop. This feature is still in macOS today via Mission Control, and I use it probably hundreds of times a day. And Quartz Extreme is what makes this animation possible. So to me, Panther felt like the first big feature release for macOS 10 since its inception. I know Apple has a lot of other good stuff waiting in the wings, so it was hard for me to compare it against those other systems and choose A or B. But in the end, I chose a B, just because I know there's lots of other good stuff coming down the pike. And if you disagree with me, that's okay too. Hey, that's why I let you guys vote. All right, up next, macOS 10.4 Tiger. And this was a critical release for Apple's product strategy. Tiger introduced the dashboard for displaying widgets, which we still have in macOS today, although it's more in a sidebar format. And it also introduced Spotlight for insanely fast file search, another feature still present in macOS today. And Tiger was the first retailed version of macOS 10 to run natively on Intel. And this was important because future Macs were gonna have Intel processors as Apple transitioned away from PowerPC. And the first Intel Macs shipped in January 2006 and they were powered by macOS 10 Tiger. This transition set up Apple to make more power efficient systems because it's not about performance, it's about performance per watt. So they can get more power and get more performance out of a system, but also have greater battery life and less heat output, which is very important for portable systems. Apple updated their developer tools so devs could create universal binaries of their apps, which would run on PowerPC and Intel Macs. And macOS 10 Tiger also had Rosetta built in, so if you were using a PowerPC app that wasn't universal, you could still run it as is with Rosetta for backward compatibility. So macOS 10 Tiger was looking great, and on a personal note, this was the first version of macOS 10 I ever used, and it was back when my family got our first iMac in 2007. So I'm giving Tiger an A, because it truly is a badass system. But now, we must focus on the next big cat, and I mean big. In terms of Apple's marketing, this was the biggest feature update in macOS 10 in history. macOS 10.5 Leopard was packed with over 300 new features. This release also introduced a more unified theme with the user interface, doing away with the mix of pinstripes, brushed metal, and light gradients. All windows now had a simple gray gradient. The Finder was also completely redesigned with a new sidebar inspired by iTunes. It even had cover flow back then. The new menu bar is semi-transparent and the new dock is three-dimensional and reflective. Stacks let you easily browse folders in the dock, and Quick Look lets you preview documents with a simple tap of the spacebar, a feature I use dozens of times a day. Leopard also had Bootcamp Assistant built in, and that application helps users partition their hard drive and install drivers so they could run Windows on their Mac. It was available in the past as a beta download, but now it's built into the system. And arguably, the biggest feature in Leopard was Time Machine. I mean, heck, it got its own TV commercial. It had a hella cool user interface. And Time Machine automatically backed up your Mac, so if you needed to restore a deleted file or restore your whole system, Time Machine has your back. Something Leopard ditched, though, was classic support. So if you had those macOS 9 or earlier apps, you could not run them anymore. But hopefully, after being in the macOS 10 world for 6 years, those applications have been carbonized or rewritten in Cocoa by now. Leopard was the first macOS 10 upgrade I ever experienced in my Mac journey, and it was flawless. That, combined with the updated user interface and the over 300 new features, absolutely scores this system an A in my book. Which brings us to the next OS, Snow Leopard. But that's kind of a different story. In fact, it's quite the polar opposite of Leopard, initially being advertised with zero new features. This one, I guess you could say, is a bit of an odd duck, so we're gonna have to talk about it later. For now, we're gonna move on to macOS 10.7, Lion. The philosophy behind Lion was to bring iOS innovation back to the Mac. For example, apps can automatically resume themselves when you reopen them, and files will automatically save, and scroll bars would automatically hide and show when necessary. All of these features were part of the iPhone and iPad user experience, and Apple wanted the Mac to share those features. In addition, Lion also featured an iPad-like launchpad for opening apps, and an app store for installing them. Lion also introduced a new method for full-screen apps, where the applications live in their own space instead of taking over the whole desktop. Mission Control was another new feature, and it was like Exposé on steroids. It showed the spaces across the top and windows on the bottom, grouped by application. In addition to the autosave feature, Lion introduced versions, which allows users to roll back individual documents and even copy-paste between the past version and the current version side by side. And Lion introduced another huge convenient feature that's still used by a ton of people today, AirDrop. AirDrop lets you simply drag a file onto another computer in the Finder, and it copies the file over ad hoc Wi-Fi. There were some complaints that Apple was making macOS too iOS-ish, but I didn't have a problem with that. I think people were kind of missing the point to a certain extent because it was still a very capable OS. However, there was one other limitation that might have affected some people's workflows, but it's part of Apple's strategy to push forward and implement new technologies. Remember Rosetta, which enabled PowerPC apps to run as is on Intel Macs? Well, that got ditched in Lion, so if your workflow needed PowerPC apps that weren't universal, you could not use Lion. Personally, the lack of PowerPC support didn't bug me. What bugged me more was there was no search bar in the launch pad, and I'm a heavy keyboard shortcut user, so although the feature looked cool, I didn't use it because it wasn't practical to me. I needed a search bar. Another tidbit, Lion was the first web-distributed version of macOS. It was distributed through the App Store as opposed to physical CDs and DVDs. But if you needed to buy a physical flash drive to install it, you could get one from Apple's website. So I'm giving Lion a B. Overall, Lion was pretty great, but it has some competition against other versions of macOS, including its successor, which may earn some more points. And of course, I'm talking about macOS 10.
Sea Lion?
Oh, Craig, no. Mountain Lion. macOS 10, Mountain Lion. The first change that stuck out to me is the redesigned 3D dock with a frosted glass finish. Very nice. In the spirit of bringing more of the iOS experience to the Mac, Mountain Lion introduced messages, notes, and reminders. And a new notification center was also built in, just like on iOS. And check out that linen. Oh, and Game Center. Almost forgot about that one. There was a lot of skeuomorphic design in the system, which some people liked and some people didn't, but when Apple got rid of that stuff in the next release, they even joked about it. So maybe they weren't really big fans of it either.
Absolutely no virtual cows were harmed in the making of this user interface.
And yes, they added a search bar to the launch pad. Thank you. Mountain Lion, I'm totally giving you an A. Plus, you sold for only $19.99. That's the cheapest price of any paid version of macOS. Now, Mountain Lion was the last big cat release of macOS because after that, you know, you have nine cats, you kind of got to move to something else. So Apple moved to notable California locations like Mavericks. Mountain Lion was also the last paid version of macOS because with Mavericks on out, even until today, all of the upgrades are free. But the story doesn't end there. We still got to go back to 2009 and talk about Leopard's successor, Snow Leopard. Snow Leopard was initially advertised as having zero new features. I was confused by this, but eventually it made sense. Snow Leopard's goal was to be a better Leopard, filled with refined features, new technologies, and Microsoft Exchange support. Snow Leopard introduced Grand Central Dispatch, a new way for developers to leverage multi-core processing power and speed up their apps. Also, OpenCL, so applications could leverage the compute power of the GPU for computational tasks. And QuickTime 10. Not only did it have a pretty new player with auto-hiding features, but an all-new backend with incredible speed and HTTP streaming integrated. There were a lot of refinements across the board, but my favorite was the Stacks update. In Snow Leopard, you could scroll through large stacks in the dock, and you could open subfolders too. Leopard didn't allow for these features. Snow Leopard was also an end of the era product, truly it was. You could run PowerPC apps on it with Rosetta, but you could not install this system on a PowerPC Mac. It was Intel only from here on out. Until Apple Silicon comes along, but it's 2009, we don't know that yet. Snow Leopard was the first macOS 10 to receive a price drop. Aside from the 10.1 Puma update, other versions of macOS 10 retailed for $129, but Snow Leopard only cost $29, so that's pretty awesome. Snow Leopard was a solid OS, which paved the way for the future with new features and technologies we still use today, and it is absolutely 100% worthy of an S tier rank. So this is my tier list. It was kind of hard to decide in some areas, but I think it's a fair assessment. But now, I'm gonna look at all of your guys' votes for the first time and see how close your votes were to my list. And before I get into the results, I just have to give a huge thanks to Mr. McIntosh for helping me fact check this episode. And another big thanks to Maniac Mike. He was helping me a ton behind the scenes. You guys are awesome. Okay, let's take a look at the data. Ranks will be rewarded based on popular vote. And it looks like you gave macOS 10 Cheetah a C. Not as harsh as my E, it seems, but 9.7% of you guys did vote for E as well, so hey, I won some of you over, I guess. Your votes also gave Puma a C, and Jaguar barely just got a C. Jaguar was 0.5% below a B rank, so close. Panther scored a B, and Tiger scored an S tier rank, which I do agree with. I was being a little tough with my judgments, but I think an S for Tiger is absolutely appropriate. And you guys gave Leopard an A, and to no surprise, you gave the mighty Snow Leopard an S tier rank. The verdict is in, based on my judgments and your guys' popular vote, macOS 10 Snow Leopard is the best big cat version of macOS. 65.3% of the Snow Leopard votes were S rank, so it seems most people agree. As for Lion, you guys gave it an A, and the same for Mountain Lion. So here are the lists, side by side. I matched Snow Leopard, Leopard, Mountain Lion, Panther, and Puma. And I almost matched Jaguar. I was off by only 0.5%. But hey, 5 out of 9 still? That's a pretty good score for never having done this before. So thank you everyone for voting. This was a lot of fun. And of course, I need to give a big thanks to my friends at Linode for making this episode possible. They helped me out, and they can help you out too. So Linode offers cloud infrastructure for your applications or websites so you can scale and deploy. Whether you just want to host a simple website, maybe host a game server, or perhaps you got to do a lot of machine learning data crunching behind the scenes for an AI-driven application, Linode has the infrastructure and the technical support in place for you. And here's the cool thing. They don't just offer the infrastructure, they also have packaged applications. Linode offers out-of-box apps for game servers like TF2, CSGO, and even Minecraft. You can run your own virtual private network with OpenVPN, build an online application with Joomla's content management system, or build a video streaming site with a multitude of app choices. There's so much you can do with Linode's affordable Linux virtual machines. And to boot, they offer award-winning 24/7 technical support. To put it simply, if it runs on Linux, it runs on Linode. Visit linode.com/computerclan and click the Create Free Account button, and I'll give you a 60-day $100 credit just for watching this episode. And also, when you do that, you're supporting the Computer Clan, so thank you very much. Man, macOS 10 has come such a long way. Not only is it running on millions of Macs every day, but the core of it is what evolved into iOS, iPadOS, WatchOS, and tvOS, which collectively are running on over 1.8 billion devices all over the world. And I can't wait to see what comes next at Apple's Worldwide Developers Conference in June. So subscribe, stay tuned, and catch the Krazy and pass it on.